All right, we are finally outside again. I saw one of the comments a while back said, too many books, not enough trees. Well, I agree. It's just not always easy to get out here. So we're out again, and we're going to be talking today about depression and the Bible believer. Notice I did not say the sin of depression or how to fight depression or things like this. It's the subject of depression that we're going to be talking about today and how it relates to a Bible-believing Christian. Now, there are 3 points that we're going to be making in this study. Okay, 3 sections of this study. Number one, I'm going to show you that depression is not a sign of mental illness. It's not a sign of mental illness. Number two, modern quote-unquote science cannot cure depression. Did you know that? You say, well, I don't know that. There's some good medicines. We're going to see about that. And it's not going to be just my opinions. I'm actually going to show you professionals from the industry telling you they can't cure depression with a medicine. What falls under the category of medicine? Okay, number three, only the Bible offers true solutions for depression. So let's start out by defining this thing of depression. All right, what is depression? Did anybody in the Bible have what people would call depression? Let's look about that. Isaiah chapter 53. Did a study on this subject many years ago. I think it was probably 2009. And a lot of new information has come out since then. Lord's shown me some new things, very interesting things. And so I thought, you know, I think it's time I need to redo the old study on depression. So there's going to be some material that's the same, but a lot of new things here. Isaiah chapter 53. Verse 1, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground, he hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. All right, this is talking about Jesus Christ. This is a prophecy of the Messiah that's coming. Now, the modern day Jews that reject Jesus will say, no, this is talking about Israel. It's talking about him, when we see him, not Israel, okay? And here's where it gets interesting, this issue of depression. Look at verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Jesus was whipped before he was crucified. Verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He is the sacrifice, that perfect sacrifice, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. The Lord laid the iniquity of us on him. So if you want to get to heaven, you need to find somebody who died in your place, somebody that lived a sinless life, which Jesus Christ did. You can't earn your way to heaven. Verse 7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. Doesn't really make much sense, too, by the way, if you'd make it Israel. The transgression of Israel, was he Israel stricken? It doesn't make any sense. Now, it's talking about Jesus Christ. It's a prophecy of Jesus. And he fulfilled it, too, by the way. And then you say, well, why didn't he fulfill all the other prophecies of the Messiah? Because the Jews rejected him as their Messiah. But he's going to be fulfilling that at the second coming. If they would have accepted him as their Messiah, there would have been, you know, this problem. But verse 9, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. All right, again, it's a prophecy of Jesus. But did you notice there, verse 3 and 4 and a lot of the other parts down through, Jesus was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Now, you can say what you want, but I look at that and I say, that's depression. Well, then Jesus must have had a problem then. He had some mental illness and things. No. He was a man that understood what this world was about. And I'm just going to spoil some of the surprise, so to speak, of this sermon, because we're going to be talking about this as we go through it. But depression is actually not a sign of mental illness. It's a sign of mental wellness. When you understand what's going on in this world, and when you understand the reality of sin, and when you understand the reality of a lot of other things, you're not going to look at this world and say, everything's getting better, like evolution teaches. Evolution is a opium pipe dream. Okay, you got to be a little bit mentally sick in the head to believe in evolution, truly believe in evolution. You say, well, then why do so many people believe it? Because it's the only theory out there that can attempt to get rid of God. That's why people believe in evolution. They come out here and they say, this all happened by random chance at some undetermined time in the past, billions of years ago. Because they couldn't say just thousands of years ago, because there's no way that all this could have happened by random chance over just a few thousand years. So they have to say, well, it must have been billions of years ago, even though we can't prove it. You know, and they try to come up with all kinds of nonsense, you know, wacky nonsense, but that's a whole other study. But you see, evolution philosophy says things get better with time. The Bible says, no, actually they get worse until God himself has to step into the picture and supernaturally change things. Kind of like your life as a sinner. Isn't it interesting? What goes on with nature, what goes on with the world, things get worse until God supernaturally changes it in the millennial kingdom. It's the same thing. It's a mirror image of us as sinners. Things get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse in your life until God steps in and supernaturally changes it. And all you got to do is ask. That's it. Come to him and say, hey, I need help. Come in a repentant, contrite, broken spirit and say, I made my life a mess. I need help. Please help me. I got to get out of this, you know, and God will fix you. And he will help you to fight those sins. You will be born again, a new creature in Christ Jesus. But let's look at the New Testament tie-in here to Isaiah 53. Matthew chapter 23. Where does it say about Jesus having sorrow? I mean, I'm sure it would be rather frustrating for the creator of the world, the God of the universe, to come down and to walk around among men. He can read their thoughts. He knows what's going on and everything. That'd be rather vexing. I mean, I'm just vexed walking around people and just looking at them and thinking, yeah, you know, man, I can see that they're in this or that, or into that or whatever else. But imagine being able to understand everybody's thoughts. Just being in this sinful world and just the vexation that the Lord felt. But there was a certain thing that was very special to the Lord. Matthew chapter 23, verse 37. Through 39 says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. They had free will. God wasn't forcing them to reject him as their Messiah. They had the free will. They would not accept him. Verse 38, behold, your house is left unto you desolate. For I say unto you, ye shall not see me henceforth, till ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Why didn't Jesus fulfill all the things of the prophecies of the Messiah? Because they rejected him. That's why. And he said, you're not going to see me again until that second coming. That right there, you want the scripture that says, number one, he suffered from sorrow. Yeah, that's there. But number two, you want a scripture that says, why didn't he fulfill it all the first time? Right there, Matthew chapter 23, verse 37 through 39. They rejected him as their Messiah, and he said, okay, you're going to have to, your house is going to be left to you desolate. There's going to be some really bad times coming for the Jewish people. And when I come back, it's going to be after the time of Jacob's trouble. But did anybody else in the New Testament have some issues with what we would call depression? Turn to Romans chapter 9. Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 5. says here, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. Now, if you went to the doctor, a modern day doctor today, a psychiatrist or some other person like that, or even just a regular medical doctor, they're prescribing people these drugs too, but you know, antidepressants, and you said, they said, how are you feeling? And you said, I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. They would, there's not one of them that would say it though. That sounds okay. And they'd all say, you have depression problems. All of them would. I actually heard a guy, I'm going to be, you know, putting a link to the video at the end. I'll be talking about this, but he said a woman came to him and she said, I'm suffering from depression. And he said, how long have you been suffering? And she said, since they diagnosed me with depression. So let me get this straight. You didn't know you were depressed until the doctor told you that you were depressed and put you on the medication. That's exactly it. But look at verse 3. Why was Paul upset? Why was he sad? For I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. It's not spiritual Jews he's talking about there. How do you know? Keep reading. Who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom as concerning the flesh Christ came, who was over all God blessed forever. Amen. Huh. Isn't that interesting? So Jesus Christ was upset. His sorrow came because the Jews had rejected him as their Messiah. And Paul was upset because those same Jews were still rejecting Jesus as their Messiah. So how can you tell me that somebody who's truly born again would not only not be upset about the Jews, their rejection of Jesus as their Messiah, but actually hate them and say that God is done with the Jews, with the nation of Israel, and replaced it with the church. You know, white Northern Europeans, the lost 12 tribes, and they're the real true Jews or something like this, or the black African Americans and the Native Americans are the different tribes and stuff like that. A bunch of satanic nonsense. Absolute satanic nonsense. And you know, people ask this question, well, how do you debunk it? Very simple. The Bible promises geographic real estate, land, to the children of Israel. So if you're one of the children of Israel, if you truly replace the Jews, then head on over to Israel, to the land of Israel and the city of Jerusalem, and you take it by force. Matthew chapter 11 says the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. So head on over to Jerusalem and take your land that God promised you if you're a true Jew. Okay? And by the way, if you are truly Jewish and you are here in America, you would do well to try to get back over to Jerusalem. All right? That's going to be important. I mean, get saved. You know, you ought to get saved. And then the Lord will be with you and He'll lead you and guide you. But if you reject Jesus Christ, well then head to Jerusalem, because that's going to be very important in the future. If you don't know what, you know, the method that the Lord used to get Jews to leave Germany and head back to Jerusalem, or Israel, I should say, the land of Israel, you better think about that and think about America's future. And then watch the anti-Semitism in this country rising and rising all the time. I love you enough to tell you the truth. But you know what? It brings me sorrow. I'm not Jewish. I don't have, you know, I can't say that they're my kinsmen according to the flesh. I can't say that. But I have love for the Jews. Why? I'm saved. My Savior is a Jew. This whole book is written by Jews. Why would I hate the Jewish people? Why would I have ill feelings toward the Jewish people? And it should bring us sorrow when we think about those Jews and we see the wickedness in Israel right now, the nation of Israel, and we hear about people being killed and things like this. It should bring us sorrow in our hearts. It did to Jesus. It did to Paul. Why doesn't it to you? Better be real careful speaking against that nation. But let's continue. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. What's the tie-in between Jesus and Paul? Well, here's what Paul writes about that. You know, and again, I got to kick something while I'm on this little subject here, and that is, so many people are trying to pit Paul and Jesus against one another. I go with the words of Jesus. Well, I go with the words of Paul, and blah, blah. Like they're two different, you know, groups or something, two different people or something like this. Like Jesus would be opposed to the Apostle Paul or something, and Paul would yell at Jesus. It's God's book. I'll grant you, you have to rightly divide it dispensationally. That's there. If you're saved, you'll understand dispensational theology. If you haven't studied it, you need to look into it because it's the truth. The Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. If you reject dispensationalism, well, God will reject you because you're lost. But, I mean, if you study it and you reject it, I'm saying. But the fact of the matter is Jesus and Paul are both saved. Obviously, Jesus is, he is salvation. So to say that somehow Jesus and Paul are opposed to each other and you can, I'm going to take Jesus' side, or I'm going to take Paul's side. Some of the stuff people are coming up with nowadays, it's absurd. But what does Paul say about Jesus? Philippians 3:10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. See, Paul didn't say, now I've brought in a new system and you just, the stuff about Jesus and what Jesus went through, you just reject that. Just get that out of your life. Don't even think about Jesus. That's not what Paul taught. Paul said, I want to know him. How do you get to know somebody? You just say and say, oh, I saw you once before, I know you. No, to know somebody on a very close level, you have to know things about them. How do they feel about certain things? Where are they from? What are their favorite colors? What are the foods that they like? What are this? What are that? Know as much as you can about that person. So how can we as Christians, following Paul's example, how can we know Jesus Christ? Well, it says it right in the text. The power of his resurrection. You want to know him and have the power of his resurrection? Sure you do. But how about the fellowship of his sufferings? Let's see, what did Jesus go through? His own people, his own kindred, turned against him. Have you had family members and friends and co-workers and things turn against you? Yeah. Fellowship of his sufferings. What about having some disciples? Having some people that are close to you and you think to yourself, wow, this is really great. I've been able to disciple them, teach them the Bible, and share scriptures with them and stuff like this. Do you have that? If you do, maybe you're just newly saved. You haven't quite gotten there yet. You'll get there eventually. But if you do have some disciples, you're going to follow Jesus' sufferings. You're going to have a John disciple, which is a great thing. You're going to have one that loves you and does things for you and helps you and is real just a closer than a brother. You're going to have a Peter. The Peter that kind of misrepresents you with some of what you tell them. And they go out and they stick their foot in their mouth and you're just going like, that's not what I said. I didn't say that. You know, you're making me look stupid or something here. You're going to have that. You're also going to have Judas Iscariot. Somebody that you thought was close to you and near to you, and they will stab you in the back so bad you won't know what hit you. Are you ready for that? And some of those other disciples, you really don't hear a whole lot about them. You'll have that. I can't tell you how many people have come along with me over the years and have said, hey, Brother Brian, I really appreciate your preaching and teaching, and I hear from a little bit, and I write back and forth as much as I can with them, and it's just like, they're gone. And I'm just like, wonder what happened to so-and-so, you know, and I'll say to my wife, when was the last time we heard from them? I don't know, I've been a while, you know, what happened? Did I offend them, or did they just go away, and they're doing their own thing now, or whatever, they have their own disciples, and I don't know. It's not good or bad. I'm just simply stating the fact. Fellowship of his sufferings. You're going to see people doing things that's going to vex you. You're going to look at the Jewish nation and you're going to go, oh. Fellowship of his sufferings. You're going to be a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, depression. Jesus had it. He was God manifest in the flesh. You have some new secret route figured out that you're not going to get depressed once in a while? You're not going to look at the world and just go, oh. You know, you look at Jesus over and over again with his disciples and he's going, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Just like, oh. He's frustrated with people. You'll get frustrated with people. And how about being made conformable unto his death? Read Romans chapter 12. I think verse 1, verse 2, I think is where it's in there. About being not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You're to present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 1. You know, you're going to have to die to self. You're going to have to look at those things that you used to get pleasure from before you were saved back in your lost life. And you're going to have to say, you know what? Those things are sin. The Bible says that I'm not supposed to do that. Common sense says I shouldn't do that. I'm going to look like a fool when I stop doing it. But you know what? Am I going to follow the Lord or the world? Dying to self. You see? And I'll tell you right now, the more you die to yourself, the more you'll experience that power of the Lord. And there is not one thing on this earth that is better than experiencing the power of the Lord, the power of His resurrection. And that's interesting too. What is the power of His resurrection? He dies, He's buried, and He comes back. He's resurrected. He's a new man. Oh, there's no such thing in the Bible as when you get saved that you have to become a new creature in Christ Jesus. You don't have to live a changed life. You just kind of go on and you have a profession of faith and you just kind of continue on. Mm-hmm. The power of His resurrection. We're new creatures in Christ Jesus. Get that figured out. If you're an easy believism heretic, you better really start to think about that and get it figured out. Next, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7 through 14. Good advice here. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. Just read about him being raised from the dead, the power of His resurrection. Verse 9, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. You know, if they ever kill me, if they ever take my channel down and I get put in prison and they take my wife off someplace and my son away from us or whatever else, well, that doesn't stop this book. They can do whatever they want to me and you as a Christian, but the word of God's not bound. You can't change it. You can't mess with it. That's why these stupid witches and their psyop thing, if you've seen the last two videos that we put out, they're trying so hard to destroy your faith in the book because it's the only thing that they can't mess with. It's a supernatural book. Verse 10, therefore I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Back to the Jews again. Yeah, they are the elect that's written about there. It's not talking about saved people in the passage, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. He's saying they're elect, but they should obtain salvation. Talking about Jews. Paul's enduring all things for them. Your ministry will eventually get you in contact with some Jews someplace, somewhere, somehow, and you'll be able to testify to a Jew at some point in time. I've had it happen a couple times. You know, I mean, I had an older truck that I sold before I got my other one. Actually, it was kind of funny because my old truck was a 1994, and my newer truck that I have right now, newer as in the time that I've owned it, is a 1979. So, you know, but the guy I sold it to was a Jew. So, verse 11, it is a faithful saying, and of course we reach Jews through the internet too, which is a blessing. Verse 11, it is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with Him, we shall also live with Him. If we suffer, kind of like depression, we shall also reign with Him. If we deny Him, He also will deny us. If we believe not, yet He abideth faithful, He cannot deny Himself. Of these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. Yeah. And of course, verse 15, there you have I'll read it quick. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Until you rightly divide this book, it's not going to make sense to you. So check out some of our stuff on dispensational teaching. And it will make sense of a lot of the hard to understand parts of Scripture. Dispensationalism is not an option if you're a Bible-believing Christian. Only heretics teach against dispensational teaching. All right, Roman Catholics and other ilk like that. But if you want to see other men in Scripture who experienced depression, I'll give you a couple references. We're not going to go there for sake of time, but Elijah, 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 through 8. He does this great deed for the Lord and, you know, defeats the priests of Baal and chops 400 priests' heads off. And then Jezebel, the queen, says, I'm going to go out and kill you. And he goes running out into the desert, runs away from a woman, you know, and he's out there and he basically is having a nervous breakdown. And he says at one point, you know, take away my life. Depressed. Interesting. How about Jonah? Jonah chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. You can read there. Again, he asked for God to take away his life. Jacob, Genesis chapter 42, verse 38. Another one you can read there. Job, the book of Job, chapter 17, verse 7. King David, Psalm 13, 1 through 6. Again, you're going to see the thing of sorrow and depression. And King Solomon, Ecclesiastes 1, 16 through 18. The richest man and the wisest man outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he had more women, over 1,000 women to choose from, not one-night stands, but women that were there, that he could, you know, 700 wives, I think it was 700 wives, 300 concubines, I think is the way it was. I might have that mixed up, but the point is, he had everything by earthly standards, and yet he said, vanity of vanities, all is vanity and vexation of spirit, you know. Depression. Sure. It's right there. Now let's go on to the second part of this study. Modern quote-unquote science cannot cure depression. All right. Now I'm going to show you two videos here back to back. The first one is a pharmaceutical representative, well, former pharmaceutical representative. Her name is Gwen Olson. And she's going to tell you about the whole antidepressant scam that's out there. And the second one is a little bit longer. And it's a Dr. Peter Gotche, I think is how you say his name. I think he's Norwegian or something. I forget. Sorry if I'm not saying that right. But that video there is, it's longer, but he really says a lot of very, very, very important things. He says about the pharmaceutical industry is an organized criminal racket. And, you know, very important information. And again, you know, I'm showing you, the reason I'm showing these videos is to show you that it's not just some wacky preacher with a King James Bible in hand out in the middle of the wilderness of Maine ranting and raving that antidepressants are of the devil or something. No, it's actually people from the industry. All right, I don't need to hide from real science. Okay, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but watch these videos.
My name is Gwen Olson, and I am the author of Confessions of an RX Drug Pusher. I'm a 15-year veteran of the pharmaceutical industry, and I left in the year 2000. And what I would like to do today is I would like to dispel the myth that the pharmaceutical industry is in the business of health and healing. Because in fact, what the pharmaceutical industry is in the business of doing is disease maintenance and symptoms management. They are not in the business to cure cancer, to cure Alzheimer's, to cure heart disease, because if they were, they would be in the business of putting themselves out of business, and that in fact doesn't make sense. I don't want people thinking that I am a conspiracy theorist, because in fact there is no theory behind what I'm telling you. It's all provable. And what I'm saying is provable is that the pharmaceutical industry doesn't want to cure people. You need to understand, specifically when we're talking about psychiatric drugs in particular, that these are drugs that encourage people to remain customers of the pharmaceutical industry. In fact, you will be told if you're given a drug such as an anxiolytic or an antidepressant or an antipsychotic drug that you may be on the drug for the rest of your life. And very frequently, people find that they are on the drugs for a very long period of time, if not permanently, because they're almost impossible to get off of. Some of them can have very serious withdrawal symptoms. Most of them can have extremely serious withdrawal symptoms if they're stopped cold turkey. But some people even experience withdrawal symptoms when they try to titrate or they try to eliminate the drug little by little, day after day. So it's really important to understand the motivation behind all of the current maintenance drugs that are on the market. Even, for example, drugs such as cholesterol-lowering drugs. And what we are in fact finding now is that cholesterol drugs are lowering cholesterol excessively and causing other disease states as a consequence. So you need to be careful about trying to take drugs in order to remain healthy, because you're never going to have anyone come to you and tell you that the drugs are always tried against a placebo in clinical trials. What a placebo is a sugar pill. And in fact, many drugs are not found to be much more efficacious than the sugar pill. And in a case in point, actually, is the recent clinical trials that were released in the meta-analysis that came out of the UK on antidepressants, on the newer SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor antidepressants. And what was found was the information that activists and other researchers have known for decades, was that antidepressants are no more effective than placebo, no more effective than sugar pills. But yet there are over 44 million people that have been taking these antidepressants, and a large number of them people that have mild to moderate depressive episodes. In fact, they prove that the antidepressants were not effective in anyone with the exception of some of the most severely depressed patients. And I can tell you from personal experience that there are a number of things that depressed patients can do to improve their mental status aside from drugs that are quite effective, and in fact more effective than placebo. Another recent study that was released showed that exercise was in fact more effective than either placebo or the antidepressant drug that they were compared to. But just like Bill Maher said in his show, you know, we're never going to hear any ads on television that are sponsored by anybody saying, you know, the New England Journal just announced that exercise is twice as effective as antidepressants in curing depression. Ask your doctor if getting your butt off the couch is right for you. You know, you're never going to get that kind of good information, fair balanced information, as long as pharma is funding the major TV stations, the advertising that supports those television stations, the major journals, and all of the advertising that supports the major journals. You just have to be commonsensical people and understand that the pharmaceutical industry makes 5 to 6 times the amount of money as any of the other Fortune 500 companies in the United States of America. They are not going to easily or readily give up that income. And we are, in fact, considered a human commodity. Our loved ones, our children, our elderly are considered cash cows that are preyed upon by pharmaceutical reps such as myself, who are encouraged to go in and build market shares without thinking about the consequences to patients, without knowing the misinformation that they are distributing, without being aware that the clinical data has been contrived, or that the patient populations have been cherry-picked, or that the side effects have been minimized and reported in such a manner that it doesn't present the information correctly. I spent 15 years in this industry. I was one of the best of the best, but I'm here to tell you that the industry has run amok, that we are at a severe crossroads in this nation, and that we have got to take our power back, and we have got to start making the pharmaceutical industry accountable for their actions and for the defective products that they're putting on the market. It won't be long before every American is affected by this disaster, and we need to be aware of what the differences are between diseases, between disorders, and between syndromes. Because if it doesn't have to be scientifically proven, if there are no tests, if there are no blood tests, CAT scans, urine tests, MRIs, if there is nothing to document that you have a disease, then you in fact do not have a disease, you have a disorder. And it has been given and has been diagnosed pretentiously. And you need to get yourself educated and understand that there are options, and those options are much more effective than drugs. You need to look into the nutritional aspects of your diet and your lifestyle aspects. Are you exercising? Are you taking care of yourself in the ways that you need to be proactive about your health? Because once you start down the road of taking one prescription drug on top of the other, you will be a lifelong customer for the pharmaceutical industry, and your choices will be truncated. So I would like to ask you to please self-educate, be proactive, and share the information with others. The next victim could be someone that you love. Thank you.
No one better to tell us what we will do about overdiagnosis than our first speaker, Peter Gotchard. He co-founded the Cochrane Collaboration in 1993, which may end up being his most important legacy but I know he's got a lot of fight left in him, and we can only stand back in awe as he tells us what we will do about overdiagnosis. Peter.
I write that drugs are the third leading cause of death in the Western world after heart disease and cancer. And partly and mostly because the business model of the drug industry is organized crime. But they steal far more money and kill far more people than the mob can ever do. So we need to do something. We need to demedicalize our societies.
So Peter is one of the people in the world who actually looks at the data beyond the biases, beyond the pharmaceutical industry, to see what it really says about whether treatments work or not. And he's also got the courage to speak out and say the things that need to be said.
To reach the threshold for evidence of effectiveness, you have to meet the threshold for good study criteria. And I think every scientist on the planet would agree that the thresholds set by the Cochrane Foundations are very high thresholds, but they're scientifically sound.
It grew out of frustration among some researchers that we cannot trust the published literature. It is flawed and some of it is fraudulent. And 3 years before we started the Cochrane collaboration, I had defended my thesis in Copenhagen, where I had reviewed arthritis drugs, painkillers, and came to the conclusion that the clinical trials that were being done with these drugs were pretty unreliable. So we wanted to do better and to find the biases in these trials and come closer to the truth than what the drug industry wanted us to come to. Well, we developed methods for aggregating results from several trials and how to scrutinize these trials in great detail to find flaws in them that are not obvious at a quick reading. So it demands some kind of detective work, just like as in police work. Through litigation, we got unpublished data. It's very sad when you use such a fantastic instrument as the randomized trial is and abuse it for monetary gains. But when the drug industry cheats with its data, it can sometimes kill tens of thousands of patients. So it's far worse. And yet, we have a system where drug regulators rely on what the industry tells them. And if the industry manipulates the evidence, they can often earn billions of dollars compared to if they were honest. What I have seen in psychiatry is worse than what I have seen anywhere else. It's just incredible the extent to which the drug industry has cheated with its trials and how it has withheld even lethal harms, suicides, from public view. I investigated the 10 biggest pharmaceutical companies in the world and found out that their business model fulfilled the criteria for organized crime according to US law. And organized crime is very serious. It can be fraud, bribery in form of kickbacks, other types of corruption. And it involves that you do the same type of crimes repeatedly, even when you are told not to, and even when you agree with the US Department of Justice and you sign an agreement never to do it again. Then the companies do it again and again because crime pays. The fines they get for the crimes are a tiny fraction of what they earn by the crimes. So you can't expect them to stop being criminals. Antipsychotics are extremely dangerous drugs. And Zyprexa, for example, is so popular and used so much that I have estimated that with that drug, Eli Lilly has killed around 200,000 people. So these death tolls are just enormous. and tells us that we need to be much, much more conservative with drugs than we are currently.
To me, Peter is one of my medical heroes. To be sitting debating at the same table as him is a bit like somebody who likes football playing at a match with Ronaldinho or Pele, because he's, I think, one of the top figures in the whole world at the moment.
The problems that my research is pointing to in New Zealand are occurring elsewhere in the world. So we see that a marketing model has been applied to the promotion of psychiatric medications, and I'm not convinced that that has been necessarily for the public good.
Prescription drugs had been a new epidemic. People would have done a lot to conquer that epidemic, even if the number of deaths had only been a tiny fraction of the number of deaths that drugs cause. And yet, somehow, because it's drugs, people do absolutely nothing. So I want to tell people with my book that drugs are so dangerous that doctors cannot handle them safely, and our authorities, the FDA, cannot guarantee the safety we need in order to take drugs, because otherwise it wouldn't be the third leading cause of death. That's pretty obvious. I call psychiatry the drug industry's paradise, because it's so easy to manipulate just about everything. The way you come up with a diagnosis is easy to manipulate. So if we are not cautious, we will all end up being psychiatric patients if we don't fight against this. I don't know why people can kill so many patients in psychiatry and nobody does anything. But what is so tragic about these drugs is that they can have an effect in some patients in the short term, but if you continue using them, they actually create psychiatric diseases, which is a disaster. And my conclusion is that the doctors cannot handle this this duality, that they can be beneficial in the short term, but they are harmful in the long term. They cannot handle it. Many doctors just go on for months and years and harm their patients in this way. It's terribly sad that the psychiatrists at large cannot see how much harm they are causing. So after having studied this in some detail, I conclude in my book that it would be better for mankind if none of these drugs existed.
My perspective on this is that I'm a family doctor. So I sit in the consulting room with the people who are really the end users of evidence and research, and also the people who are harmed by overdiagnosis and overtreatment. So I see the real effects in people's day-to-day lives. What I'm interested in is what mechanisms that we have to interrupt this flow, to restore a balance of what medical care should really offer, which is not just about medicines, it's about listening to the patient and what their problems are and being able to empathise enough to understand what they are. And then about drawing on what the best that medical science has to offer, which is where Peter and his group, people like him, come in, which is people who have a real ability to look at the data truthfully.
What do you do with a specialty that to some extent live on a lie? How do you deal with that? I have heard so many psychiatrists, also professors, say that starting an antidepressant is like giving insulin to a diabetic, which is completely wrong, and yet they still say this nonsense. What they mean is that these patients lack serotonin in their brain, So when they give a drug that increases serotonin, it should be good. But it's wrong. The hypothesis about serotonin is stone dead. The good studies that have been made could not see that depressed patients were different from normal patients. What these drugs do is they do not correct a chemical imbalance. That's another lie psychiatrists love, that you have a chemical imbalance like a diabetic that lacks insulin, so now we are going to correct your chemical imbalance. It's a lie. They are creating a chemical imbalance, and it's exactly for this reason that it's difficult for patients to stop after 2 or 3 months, because there is now an imbalance. And you know, there are even drugs that decrease serotonin that have an effect on depression. How can you say that you lack serotonin, so you need to increase serotonin, and then at the same time have drugs that are also effective that decrease serotonin? I mean, a diabetic doesn't get better if you give that person sugar.
So what's the missing link between having the evidence, and this applies across medicine, because it's really easy for us to start drugs, so easy for me to write a prescription. What are the barriers to not doing things? And one of the growth drivers for this explosion of SSRI prescription is the fact that people go on and they stay on them. Part of that is the withdrawal effects that people have coming off. But the other part is this, there are consensus guidelines that suggest that if you've had more than a couple of dark pools in your life, that maybe you need to stay on these drugs for life. But in fact, there is absolutely no data to suggest that this is helpful.
Psychiatry has gone the wrong way. Whittaker has described this beautifully in his book, Anatomy of an Epidemic, that if it were really true that psychiatric drugs helped correct some kind of imbalance in the brain, then we would expect people who receive pension and who cannot work to go down. And what have we seen? The opposite. The number of these people have exploded at the same time as we introduced these drugs. I mean, how can people not see this? We are doing more or less exactly the opposite of what we should be doing. These drugs are dangerous. They should be given in as short periods as possible and then stop. And very many patients shouldn't get them at all. Most depressed patients recover by themselves. So why not wait and see some weeks? Then many of them would never get an antidepressant, and then they would have no problem stopping the drug. What the psychiatrists then say is, I've heard that often, well, on the other hand, it's important to give these drugs because they reduce the risk of suicide. As far as I can see, this has never been documented. Quite the contrary, we know that these drugs increase the risk of suicide in young people up to the age of 40, according to FDA data, and we don't really know what they do above the age of 40, because the drug companies have cheated so enormously in their randomized trials. So in the worst case, these drugs might increase the risk of suicide in all age groups. When you discover that the business model is organized crime, and when you find out that it's far worse than mob crime, because the drug industry steals much more money from the public purse than the mafia can ever do, and they kill far, far more people. And we also know that they do this knowingly. As soon as they have their income, and as soon as people don't protest too much, it doesn't really matter that people die. So, isn't it pretty natural that you feel that this knowledge should come out to people?
All right, there you have it. Pretty interesting, isn't it? But 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20, if you're still there in 2 Timothy, you can just flip a page or so over. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 20 says, O Timothy, keep that which is committed to thy trust, avoiding profane and vain babblings and oppositions of science, falsely so called. Now, we can certainly focus in on the word science, falsely so called, because of what we just saw. The antidepressants are science, falsely so called. The thing of, you have a chemical deficiency. You don't make enough serotonin, so we need to get more serotonin into you as well as other drugs to make you feel better. No, that's false science. Okay, there's a thing in the medical establishment called homeostasis. And what that means is that everybody, they'll come up with a certain formula and everybody has to conform to that formula. I'll give you an example, blood pressure. 120 over 80, 120 over 80. Everybody has to have 120 over 80 in blood pressure. Okay? So in other words, you have a 18-year-old athlete and his blood pressure has to be 120 over 80, and a 75-year-old man that's 300 pounds overweight, his blood pressure has to be 120 over 80. That's stupid. It's extremely stupid. And again, somebody with say that they're having some stress issues and things which are leading to depression and whatever else, you say, well, we got to get you more serotonin and stuff. We got to get these more chemicals into you. Stupid. It's stupid. Our bodies are different. And I'm going to show you here in just a little bit. I'm actually going to show you the third and final part of this study. I'm going to show you the way that you can cure what I would call serious depression. In other words, not just getting sad about the condition of the world or whatever, but if you're just continually just down and just, I'm going to give you solutions for it. Okay, I'm not just going to stand here and yell and scream at you because you're on antidepressants or something. No, there needs to be solutions. All right? But notice there in 1 Timothy 6:20, it says, it doesn't just say science falsely so called, it says oppositions. Beware of oppositions of science falsely so called. See, most of modern day science is actually anti-God religious fanaticism. Evolution, global warming, there's a bunch of them. All right, we go on and on about that. Atheists will come up with ways to try to explain away God. That's what they're doing. And this whole antidepressant thing is another way to do that. You see, part of what's so important for you as a person in this world, you need to get to a point where you're broken, where you're just physically exhausted, emotionally exhausted, and you just say, God, please help me. Please save me. I'm a sinner. Somebody says, are you a sinner? Of course I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. I know I deserve to go to hell. But see, if you're taking antidepressants, it's just, oh, your serotonin level's a little bit low. Let's just give you some pills here so you can go off back to happy land again and not be convicted for your sin. That's not right. That's not right. It's an opposition of science, falsely so called. The whole pharmacopoeia thing is, pharmakia is a Greek word for witchcraft. And if you really study it out, the pharmaceutical industry is modern day witchcraft. It is using petrochemicals, things that are derived from oil, essentially, a whole other study. It's using those and creating them into pills and combining them also with a lot of illicit drugs like heroin, opium and things, opiate type drugs and other things as well. And then they bring it out in pill form and they say, it's medicine. It's not medicine, it's poison. Why do you think that there are so many side effects? You know, I mean, if somebody puts a drop of poison into your drink and you say, man, I just feel, I feel nauseous and I feel lightheaded. I feel like I'm going to throw up and I'm getting a headache. And people go, you've been poisoned. But if you go, I just took my pharmaceutical pill and you had the same symptoms, people would go, oh, you'll get over it. It's just, you know, a little bit of side effects from medicine. We live in an insane world, people. Don't let these oppositions of the pharmaceutical world, the science falsely so-called there, Don't let those oppositions take you away from what the Bible says. If you have some depression issues, first of all, come to Jesus Christ to get saved. Understand you're a sinner. It's good for you to be depressed about your sin, okay? But secondly, if you're having some depression issues, realize it's because you have common sense and you can see what's really going on in the world that we live in. You're not sick, in other words. And I understand there's real depression. Okay, I've gone through some very, very, very heavy depression in my life. All right. But let's continue. Finally, we're going to get into the biblical cure for depression. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Now, a lot of people will tell you, well, just pray about it. Just pray about it. Well, you know, prayer changes things, you know, absolutely. God can cure you. God can heal you. Sure. But is that all there is to it? I mean, does God just say, live how you want, eat what you want, don't ever exercise, don't get any sleep, whatever else, I'll take care of it, just pray to me and I'll just fix everything up. No, the Lord expects us to be in good health. The Lord expects us to do things that are not going to make us sick and not make us fall into sin. Let me show you. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, beginning in verse 24, says here, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. All right, let me just finish reading here. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. What Paul is referring to there is the ancient Greek games, running in races. You know, just like right now as I'm preaching, there is the Olympics down in Rio de Janeiro, I think it is. And there, I don't even watch Olympics or sports. Another issue. But they have these Olympic games. Do you see the Olympian athletes? Do you see them sitting around with a dozen of donuts, eating donuts and drinking soda pop and stuff like this? No. They're training and training and training and training and training. That's what we're supposed to do as Christians. You say physical training all the time? No, I didn't necessarily say physical training. That's there. Paul says in another place, bodily exercise profiteth little. Sure, bodily exercise is there, but we're supposed to look at this life and say, hey, I'm running in a race. I only have a short amount of time down here on this earth in my life here to influence other people, to preach the gospel, to live for the Lord. What you do in this life after your salvation will mean your inheritance in heaven, your rewards at the judgment seat of Christ, your millennial inheritance. I've had people say, could you do a study on the judgment seat of Christ? I do have one. Just go to the channel, main channel thing, and search the judgment seat of Christ. I already do have one on that. So, but what we do in this life leads to rewards in eternity. That's important to remember. But we have to balance the thing of your health and spiritual health. So reading your Bible, praying, witnessing to people, you know, letting the Lord sanctify you, telling you what things need to go or what things can stay or whatever else, those are all very important. But you can't let your health slide. So you do have to weigh both out. So it's not that you just say, well, pray about your health, pray about getting over depression, and it goes away. Prayer is very important. Reading your Bible is very important and things too. But there are some physical aspects to it as well, especially in our modern day world. I mean, you know, first century, everybody's eating organic food. There was no such thing as non-organic food, GMOs and genetically engineered foods. That stuff wasn't there in the first century. There were no pollutants in the air. There was no electronic smog and all this other stuff that we struggle with today. So things have changed. We have to really be careful about our health now. If you expect to be in any kind of, have any kind of strength or anything. But let's go through a couple things here. I've written down a bunch of different things that can lead to depression if you are messing around with some of this stuff. Number one, you need sleep. Okay, proper sleep. That's something that my wife and I have struggled with for a long time because the hours we work are very weird. Sometimes we're doing video and it's like, well, the video's rendering and I got to start the upload and that's going to be like the render. Editing, when you edit, then you have the whole file, all the little pictures and all the text and the video files and the audio, and you take it and make it into one file. That's called rendering, if you didn't know. And so that sometimes will go till like 12:30 or 1 o'clock in the morning, and then it's like, okay, I'm going to start the upload, because it's better upload overnight and things, you know. I know some technical stuff here, but we've struggled with the thing of sleeping for a long time. And I'll tell you what one of the big things is that has really helped us recently, and that is make it as dark as possible in your room. If you have an alarm clock with red digital numbers or something like that, get rid of it. Unplug it. Because unconsciously, you're going to be looking at that thing throughout the night, just opening your eyes and looking over at it. And even consciously, you know, you'll wake up if you have to go to the bathroom or whatever, and you'll look over at the clock and you'll think, okay, and your brain will start to work and you'll go, that's 3 o'clock in the morning. I still got to sleep for a few more hours yet, but I've only had about 2 hours of sleep. So I wonder if you'll start doing calculations. Dark room, very, very, very important. If you have to, get one of those sleep masks to go over your eyes. But, you know, put curtains or something up over your windows, get that thing dark in there. And I would have, well, getting ahead of myself. Number two, sunlight. That's why I thought I better do this study outside, because if I do it inside, people are going to be going, you know, why don't you get out and get some sunlight? So sunlight's very important. You get vitamin D when you're out here. Your skin will kind of process the you know, sunlight, and you get vitamin D. It's very, very, very important for you to be out in the sunlight. Just a little word here of simple, or actually a very interesting thing. If you look at a lot of my older videos, I had sunglasses on, little clip-on sunglasses that would go over my prescription glasses. I don't wear those anymore. I heard a theory that sunglasses can actually cause cancer. And I thought, what? You know, this is crazy. And it was like, how long have people even been wearing sunglasses? Well, they've only been wearing them not even 100 years. I think the 1920s or something. Ray-Ban, I think it was, it came out with the first sunglasses. I think. I have to check on that. But it's not been that long. People haven't been wearing sunglasses. For thousands of years, nobody wore sunglasses. Except for a few rare cases, people, emperors or things like this, would wear them to conceal their eyes or weird stuff. But nobody in just the common populace wore sunglasses until just less than 100 years ago. Now, oh, don't go out. It's dangerous. UV light's dangerous. No, it's not. But see, what sunglasses do, they trick your brain into thinking, hey, it's evening, so your body doesn't produce, I don't know if you want to call it chemicals, but it doesn't produce certain things in your skin to ward off sunburn. And I was kind of skeptical about this, and I thought, what? You know, this is ridiculous. And I thought, well, you know what? I'll experiment with it. So I came out. I remember the first time coming out, and it was just like getting out in the sunlight. You know, you're like squinting and just like, oh boy, it's really bright out here. And your eyes start to adjust, and pretty soon you're, you know, you have your eyes open more and things. And I was out all day. I wasn't even really thinking about it. In the bright sunlight, I mean, working outside, and it was just like, towards evening I got done, and I'm like, I had a little teeny tiny bit of sunburn, but barely anything. And I thought, wow. And boy, since then, I haven't worn sunglasses. And I have dark eyes too, so, you know, my eyes are extremely sensitive to real bright light, but it's a totally different thing. So again, vitamin D is good for you. And I do believe it's good for your eyesight as well. It's causing your eyes to focus on things where if they're just dark and just kind of in a sedated mode, you know, they say it can lead to cancer. I don't know, whatever, but just an interesting kind of a thing there. Thirdly, ways to fight chronic depression, not just being upset about things and sad, but I'm talking where you're just sad and you just feel your energy is just drained and you just, you know, I remember years ago I'd get into these really heavy periods of depression, and I would literally just sit in a room, a darkened room, and just sit there and just stare and just like, I don't feel like doing anything. I don't feel like eating anything. I don't feel like sleeping. I don't feel like being awake. I don't, that's bad. So I know about depression. You know, I still go through some of it, you know, but it's ways to get around it. But third big thing, non-toxic foods. That's important. Again, when I used to get really bad depression, I was eating a lot of fast food, a lot of junk food. You want to eat what is called a whole food, raw food diet. Okay, in other words, you're eating foods that are not processed. They're whole foods. Okay, they don't, like white bread, they're taking out a lot of things from the grains and stuff like that. You want to eat wheat bread. Some people have some gluten issues there and stuff, and again, that's minerals that you're deficient in. That's why you can't digest the wheat gluten and stuff like this. And Of course, there's GMO, you know, wheat, and there's non-GMO heirloom. This world's so messed up. But the point is, organic type foods, foods that are good, stuff that you can get out in nature. We come out here, you know, sometimes to pick wild edibles, learn about that. I mean, there's a lot of good things that you can do for your health. There's a very simple little thing that you need to think about, a little motto, and that is, food is medicine. I believe very, very firmly in that. And I'm going to be recommending a doctor's video here at the end of this study. And he is very big into food, eating the right kind of food, getting the right kind of sleep, exercise, stuff like that. Nutrition is very important. That's something a lot of people forsake. The other part of that is non-toxic food and environments. Right now, I am not in any kind of a Wi-Fi field at all. Wi-Fi, again, Barry Trower, I think the guy's name is, over in the UK. Listen to some of his stuff on the thing of Wi-Fi. Deadly, deadly, deadly toxic. I mean, if you have internet access at your home or whatever, shut that Wi-Fi off. Just have it plugged in, local area network connection. Wi-Fi is bad news. If you have a cell phone on you at all times, there's reasons I cut on cell phones. And my reasons my wife does too. She used to work in that field. So all this stuff, you know, and again, I'm not trying to overwhelm anybody and just say, oh, you got to just be from here to there. You know, you're on antidepressants right now and you just got to become just like Brother Brian tomorrow. Well, no, this stuff's going to take you some time. All right. It took me many years. I mean, I'm 41 years old right now. The majority of my life has been very toxic. I've only been in really good health now for, I don't even know, 3 years maybe, right around 3 years. And I'm still struggling with some things. I'm still overcoming some things. So it takes a while, brethren. Don't get frustrated thinking, oh man, there's so much to do. There is, but you'll feel that change. You'll feel you're getting better. Another thing, exercise. Very important. Extremely important to get exercise. Get out in God's creation. If you live in the city, go to a park someplace. Get out, exercise. That's so important to get your body moving. Another thing that can lead to depression is adrenal fatigue. If you're dealing with a lot of stress and you're not, your adrenals are little like kind of organs right in here, and they produce a lot of your hormones and things like that. And if you're just stressed and you're not getting much sleep and you're just work, they'll get fatigued. They won't be producing the right, you know, adrenaline types of things and hormones, and you'll just be tired and you'll be irritable and cranky and whatever else. That's something that we've been struggling with a lot here because of just working very hard this year and just a lot of the stress that goes along with ministry and, you know, so many people attacking us and stuff, and just like, you know, it gets stressful. So there's ways to fight adrenal fatigue. Adrenal fatigue also is caused by low vitamin C levels, low potassium levels, magnesium. Again, this is stuff that we're researching. You can research it on your own. I can't go into a real huge study on it here, but very important. Adrenal fatigue can definitely lead to depression. Also, omega-3 oils. Omega-3 oils. Be careful about the synthetic, going out to a drugstore and getting the capsules and things like this. A lot of times it has synthetic things in it, or it'll have different types of like canola oil or soybean oil and things. Avoid that stuff like the plague. But you mostly get it from fish. Interesting, because what did Jesus eat mostly when he was here on the earth? Fish. Interesting. Another good thing is herbal supplements. Okay, if you're really struggling with depression and you really need a good strong boost, herbal supplements are good. I'll give you a couple here. St. John's wort is known, been around for a long time to help fight melancholy, is another way to say depression. Lavender, very, very good for depression. It's an aromatherapy thing. In other words, you put lavender oil, you know, smell that and things, it will lift your mood, help you sleep really well at night. Ginkgo is another one. Kava kava, another one, another herbal supplement that you can take. St. John's wort is St. John's, apostrophe S, W-O-R-T. Okay, that's how that's spelled. Ginkgo is G-I-N-K-G-O. Kava Kava is K-A-V-A, twice with a line between. Okay? Those are just a few. But again, it's more of a nutrition thing, is what I've found in my own experience. Nutrition, sunlight, exercise. Those are the big things on the physical realm. Okay? But now let's talk about the biblical cures for depression from the Bible. Because you come to the Lord with sorrow in your heart and He saves you, and it's a wonderful thing when you first get saved and you're just like just happy and you're just going like, wow, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven when I die. This is great. Man, you know, I finally figured out what life is about. I know my Creator. I know the one who created all of this beautiful wilderness and everything else, and just wow, He made the world, you know, for us, and wow, man, this beautiful creation. And it's really neat. But then you go back into some sorrow sometimes. You get some depression sometimes. It's a normal part of being a Christian. But what things should you keep in mind to lift your spirit? Romans chapter 8, verse 1 says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them who which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." You're not in a system where you're going to be saved one day, lost another day, and then saved another day, and then I lost it again. And there's no condemnation to you. And the only condemnation that comes in the passage there, if you're walking after the flesh, if you're continuing to mess around with some sin, then the condemnation that comes on you is chastening of the Lord. He'll spank you a little bit sometimes, just to, like a good parent will their child, just to kind of correct them and say, I told you not to do that. Stop. You know, and whatever God tells you to stop, it's going to be for your good. He'll never take something away from you that's good for you. Jump down to verse 15 there in chapter 8. "For we have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with Him, that we may be also glorified together." Huh. All you got to do in this life is have some depression occasionally and suffer for Jesus Christ, and that's all it takes to reign with Him for 1,000 years? When we come back down to this earth after the time of Jacob's trouble? That's it. Just suffer a little bit for the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? Now, if I told you as a Christian that you need to eliminate depression from your life, get depression completely out of your life. If you have depression in your life, you're sinning. If I did that and told you you should be happy all the time and whatever else, I'd be taking away your millennial inheritance. That's why I'm telling you, depression is not mental illness. Depression is not a sign of you being mentally sick. It's a sign of you being mentally well. And if you're suffering from chronic depression where you're just, I can't get anything done, well then check your health and check your thoughts about the Lord, about spiritual things. Here's a real good verse, the next one, verse 18. We already read 17. "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." Wow. Think about what it's going to be like at the rapture. Incorruptible body. All the pains, all the headaches, all the health issues, gone. Temptation to sin, gone. Wondering about who's saved, who's lost, gone. You'll know who's saved. Wondering what Jesus Christ looked like, gone. We'll see Him face to face. And understanding that we're there and spared from the horrible time of Jacob's trouble. And we're going to be coming back down to the earth. It's great. Then 1,000 years of honeymoon, if you understand the marriage of the Lamb and the marriage supper and 1,000-year kingdom, the 1,000 years of rest on this earth, agrarian lifestyle, growing crops, eating wonderful food for 1,000 years here on the earth, and then eternity after that. That's what we have to look forward to. Pretty amazing. Verse 19, for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. Yeah, the Bible calls us creatures many times. Okay, that's why you read the Great Commission. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. It's talking about people. Okay, you just compare scripture with scripture, you get the definition. But we're earnestly waiting for that time when we no longer have to feel the pain, when we no longer have to be tempted to sin. When we finally have victory over Satan and his people. Verse 22, for we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. It's very interesting. You say, what does all that mean? The hope and the this and that? Well, if when you get saved, the Lord would say, okay, I'm going to make you a new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm going to give you your incorruptible body. Boom. Right there. What would be the point of us having our faith tried and things like that, waiting on the Lord? Be no point to it. What's the Lord do? The Lord says, I'm going to give you some hope. You have depression right now, but the hope is understanding what's coming in the future. Yeah, you're groaning and travailing and just like, oh, I can't believe this world's so bad. Oh, I can't believe that and that. But we have hope. That's important. And we're waiting with patience for the Lord to come back and take us out of here. And you say, why hasn't he yet? Because somebody else needs to be saved. Verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Do you ever get so depressed that you just are just like, oh. And somebody says, what's wrong? I don't know. You're like, I don't want to talk about it. I do, but I don't. I'm just tired. You ever been there? I have. I know what it's like. It's rough sometimes. But the Holy Spirit is there within us, making intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. He's doing the same thing. He knows. He feels your pain. You're not left down here with a God that doesn't care about you. He knows. Verse 27. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. For we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Write that verse down. Memorize that verse, Christian. If you struggle with depression, depression that you can't seem to get out of, you write down Romans 8:28. Never forget I have a video in my collection of Lester Roloff. And he's being taken to prison because he would not follow the state curriculum at his school for, girls and school for boys. And they were trying to force the state curriculum on him, the state of Texas. And he said, no, I'm not going to do it. And they said, we're going to put you in prison. He said, okay, I'm going to prison. And I'll never forget, he's standing outside. And right before they took him into jail, he holds up his King James Bible and he says, Romans 8:28. And it wasn't too much longer after that, he died in a plane crash. I bet you if you could have talked to Lester Roloff in his last few dying moments there, if you'd have said to him, Romans 8:28 still apply, he'd have probably looked at you with his dying breath and said, amen. Yes, it does. All things work together for good. All the problems that man had with the state and with the government and everything else, I bet you he had some times of depression. And it got so bad, the Lord said, okay, I'm taking you home, buddy. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Come up hither. Come on up. Everything worked out for good. We'll see that as we continue. Verse 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. Okay? Continue here in a minute, but you say, what is all this predestination stuff about? Well, not like Calvinism. Calvinism says that you're predestinated before you're saved. No, that's not what the Bible teaches. What's going on there in that passage is, when you get saved, your destination is fixed. You're going up. You go up to heaven. You already have that reservation made. Nothing's going to undo that. It's a great promise. Verse 31, what shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? What you're going through right now, what's it really going to mean in eternity? When God wipes away all tears in Revelation 21, verse 3, I think it is. Are you going to think back? Are you going to have days where you're just sitting up there in glory and you're just... Some brother walks by and says, hey, what's going on? I'm just kind of depressed. Of course not. That's all going to be over. The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Verse 32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Do you realize that? Not only is it the Holy Spirit up there making groanings for us, which cannot be uttered, he knows your pain, he knows what you're going through, it's Jesus Christ himself making intercession for you. He will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able to bear. He'll with that temptation make a way out. He'll make a way to escape that temptation. What great promises we have. Let's continue. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Sometimes it does get rough for Christians down here. I'm not trying to give you a positive message that says you'll never suffer again as a Christian. Once you get saved, things just get better and better. Well, some things do get better and better. That's true. You'll see some improvements in your health. You'll see improvements in your attitude. Sometimes your depression will go away for a little while. Sure. But you got to remember, we're still in a world that's fallen. And where God gives people the free will to do evil. And sometimes that evil will be directed at you as a Christian. But what's our attitude towards that? Verse 37. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. What an amazing promise we have here in this book. You have great promises. If you're saved, God is your Father. Your destination is fixed. It's secure. You don't need to worry about losing your salvation. You don't need to look out into the future and go, oh, the mark of the beast is almost here. I do the videos about the mark of the beast to warn people and say, hey, if you're not saved, get saved now. You know, whosoever will, let him come. You know, get saved. Good night. What are you waiting for? Get saved. Come to God as a broken, repentant, contrite spirit. Say, I'm broken. I need to be fixed. Save me. Put your faith in Jesus Christ, his death, burial, and resurrection. The blood that he shed is enough to pay for your sins. And once you're saved, you're heading to heaven. And God will leave you here on this earth. And God will do things for you, and God will bless you and surprise you sometimes with some of the things the Lord will do for you here in this life. But you're going to have depression at times. Make sure if it's a spiritual issue, you get that stuff fixed up. If it's physical, also get some of those things fixed up. I'm going to put a link, said about this, down in the description box. Dr. Eric Berg, he has a little video on depression, how to fight depression. From purely a nutritional standpoint, I'm not saying that he's a Bible-believing Christian or something like this. It's secular. I don't believe he's a saved man or anything, but the point is, you know, he offers some really good nutritional advice in terms of fighting depression. A lot of what I already said in this study, a few other things I haven't said, but please listen to that. If you are suffering with some health issues, if you are on antidepressants and you want to get off those antidepressants, if you're saved, you need to get off those antidepressants. If you want to do that, I would suggest you really get your health in line and wean yourself off those things. I've heard of some people that can just cold turkey, boom, quit antidepressants, but you are on a very, very, very powerful drug, as you heard the Dr. Peter Goetze say earlier. You're on a very powerful drug. You need to wean off that thing slowly. And the best way to do that is through prayer. Really pray about it, pray hard about it, but get your health in line too. Proper nutrition, proper sleep, you know, like that. That's what I would recommend, very, very strongly recommend. And let's close with a word of prayer here. Dear Heavenly Father, I do thank you, Lord, for the amazing promises of your word, for the fact that depression is not a mental illness, Lord, but it's us understanding what this world is about. And but yet, Lord, you can also give us great joy in the midst of sorrow, as I'm sure you had when you were here on this earth. And Lord, I just pray that if there's brothers or sisters out there struggling with depression, I pray that they would keep their eyes focused on eternity and on many things that we have coming, Lord. It's just such a wonderful thing. Truly, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that which shall be revealed in us. Thank you, Lord, for those promises. And I just pray, Lord, for extra strength for those out there that are struggling with depression. And Lord, if there's somebody out there that's not saved and they're hearing this, that they would get their salvation figured out. They'd come to you as a sinner and get saved. And I ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, that's going to be it. Please take my advice on this, brethren. I'm not speaking to you as somebody that's never felt sorrow or depression. I've gone through some very rough times. It's a rough world that we're living in. And my heart goes out to those who struggle with depression. I can understand. I've been there. But these are the things that are going to help you. So, that's going to be it. I'm going to enjoy the beautiful day the Lord's given us here, and I suggest you do the same. Thank you very much for watching.